Thank you. The final item of business is a Member's Business Debate on Motion 8651 in the name of Beatrice Wishart on highly protected marine areas. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now, and I call on Beatrice Wishart to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you to those members who signed the motion which allows this debate to be brought forward to the Chamber today. HPMAs are, and I quote, a blunt instrument. Not my words, but those of Shetland's only Green councillor. It's no exaggeration to say that the proposals for highly protected marine areas, or HPMAs, have struck fear and anxiety in coastal and island communities. The communication from the Scottish Government about its proposals has been poor, and had it engaged meaningfully with communities before now, it is possible that some of those concerns could have been alleviated. A great many constituents have been in contact with me highlighting the potential impact on their livelihoods, and stakeholders across Scotland have raised concerns about HPMA proposals. The three island group councils have all come out in opposition to the plans as proposed, raising once again questions over the degree to which Scottish Government policy is island-proofed. Around a third of Shetland's economy depends on fishing and aquaculture, and those in the supply chain, like hauliers and marine engineers, rely on them. Around three quarters of all Scotland's mussels are produced in Shetland, while just last week Scottish salmon was promoting their global product at Seafood Expo in Barcelona. All that could be seriously damaged by these proposals. The HPMA policy appears to be out of step with the Scottish Government's efforts in promoting Scotland's food and drink sector around the world and the strategy in Ambition 2030. One producer said, and I quote, "The HPMA proposals are already doing damage to our business as we can no longer plan." So I ask the Scottish Government to reflect on the damage this proposal is already doing to the fishing and aquaculture sectors. Without plans, it will be difficult for businesses to expand and take advantage of opportunities. My constituent goes on to say, and I quote again, "The proposals could lead to our company being put out of business." So businesses fear closure and job losses, with the wider negative impact on the whole seafood supply chain. Losses that would have a devastating outcome for coastal and island communities. And we can't leave communities on the scrap heap, of which we have seen in previous decades. It is important that the twin crises of biodiversity loss and climate change are addressed. The IPCC, the UN's Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, is clear: we cannot wait. Addressing the climate emergency and protecting our vulnerable coastal and island communities is not in doubt, but should be led by proportional and evidence-based policy, not imposed by a top-down approach. Effective local management and decision-making has already been demonstrated in my constituency through the Shetland Fishery Regulatory Order in place for over 20 years. And we've seen efforts to protect our seas through Scotland's existing Marine Protected Areas network, established in partnership with stakeholders, each designed to protect vulnerable habitats and on an evidence basis, with restrictions where certain activities are permitted. It enables conservation and sustainable use to coexist, and if the Scottish Government put more money into investment and research, it could find out what conservation measures work best where. It would be interesting to know what the Scottish Government has learned from those networks and what can be taken forward. HPMAs could see an arbitrary 10% of the seas closed to all but leisure activities by 2026. A one-size-fits-all approach won't work. Fishing has been a tradition for centuries for coastal and island communities, and it's time to stop implying fishermen don't care about our seas. The fishing sector rely on sustainable catches and benefit from healthy seas. And who better understands our seas and that they are fragile than our fishermen, and who want to ensure that there's a future for the next generation? And on proportionality, the fishing sector already faces spatial squeeze. With increasing at-sea infrastructure such as platforms, renewables, offshore wind farms and cables, as well as the network of existing protected marine areas. HPMAs could have the cumulative impact of closing off 50% of Scotland's waters to fishing by 2050. And when you consider one-third of all UK fish is caught within 50 miles of Shetland, this becomes extremely concerning. The concern is heightened when it's considered that the consultation assumes that the designation of HPMAs beyond 12 nautical miles will be subject to the prior transfer of relevant powers by the UK government to Scottish ministers. If this is not agreed, which is a possibility, then it's unclear if the 10% requirement will need to be made up of inshore waters alone. We need a holistic approach to our seas to support all the interested stakeholders and sectors, including how the future conservation of our seas should work. The Scottish Government should rethink this policy now. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms. Wishart. And I now call Karen Adam to be followed by Brian Whittle. Speeches of around 4 minutes, please, Ms. Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to thank Beatrice Wishart for bringing this debate to the Chamber today for us all to have an opportunity to speak on it. I represent a number of coastal communities across Banffshire and Buchan Coast. In recent weeks, a number of constituents of mine have contacted me on this issue, and I have held meetings with a range of stakeholders, including fisheries, to gauge their thoughts. And it is clear to me that there are significant concerns among stakeholders of the blue economy regarding highly protected marine areas. I welcome the First Minister's recent commitment to not impose upon any community a policy to which they are vehemently opposed. And last week, I asked the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero and Just Transition to echo that commitment. In response to my question, she told me she was happy to reiterate the First Minister's commitment and that she firmly believes you don't impose policies on communities. I'm grateful for her reassurance, although we do need clarity on how these communities will be defined and how we will gauge their vehement opposition. And we do need it urgently. Only today, we heard of delays in the purchase of vessels as a result of the lack of certainty. We must avoid the ambiguity and uncertainty that the Tory pursuit of Brexit saddled already on our blue economy. Many lives and livelihoods across our country, particularly in the North East, depend on fisheries and the meaningful contribution they make to both the culture and economy of Scotland. Over the last number of years, fishers have had to battle with the cumulative impact of the pandemic, Brexit and the post-Brexit immigration issues. One fisher in my constituency told me earlier today, Brexit has been damaging to the industry with all of the additional administrative costs, and it is prevalent today as it was in 2021. HPMAs cannot be introduced without the support of local communities because that's where the damage would be caused. We're being driven by an urban agenda with little consideration on the impact of our rural communities and way of life. And that fisher is by no means alone. The Sustainable Inshore Fisheries Trust told me this morning that they're concerned that the current programme has been developed without bringing in areas that are guaranteed for creelers and others for the mobile sector in economically advantageous areas where mobile gear has a lower impact. They said, we think setting the environment against the economy misunderstands the economic basis for a strong and growing fishing industry. We can either fail on both fronts or bring in the kind of spatial planning which will let us succeed on both. If we are to be successful in our efforts to tackle the climate and biodiversity crisis and restore marine habitats, we have to take the key stakeholders of the blue economy with us, and this requires a just transition. And we have to do more than just listen to fishers. We have to act on their concerns. It is clear from recent interactions with my constituents that they feel that this is not currently the case. And while I do welcome the commitments from the Scottish Government to have fully comprehensive negotiations, I must reiterate the point that this must be led by lived experience and must not resemble a top-down approach. I have always been an advocate for lived experience shaping policy, but an honest and forthcoming exchange of views requires trust. Fishers across Banffshire and Buchan Coast have put their trust in me, and I don't take that trust for granted. The coastal communities across my constituency depend on fisheries, and I will continue to stand up for those communities. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I want to thank again Beatrice Wishart for this welcome opportunity, and I also welcome further any cross-party discussions on how we can best work together for our coastal communities. So on that note, I look forward to seeing as many of my colleagues join the forthcoming cross-party group on fisheries and coastal communities that I am in the process of setting up. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Adam. I now call on Brian Whittle to be followed by Alice Rowland. Mr Whittle.
Yeah, thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I thank Beatrice Wishart for bringing this really important debate to the Chamber? The marine ecosystems worldwide store and cycle an estimated 93% of the Earth's CO2. Seagrass sequestration of carbon is 35 times faster than that of the rainforest, and also provides a fantastic renewable food source that must be managed properly if we are to maintain food security. However, the poor launch of the Scottish Government's HMPA consultation has highlighted the need to look at our blue economy with respect to a just transition in more detail. What we needed was direct consultation with communities and allowing local communities their say. It is obvious coastal communities and Scottish industries within the blue economy feel left behind, and that the Scottish Government are not delivering on their promise of a just transition for them. It is disappointing that the Scottish Government do not take a more direct approach in consulting communities on policies that would directly impact their livelihood and viability. And it's easy to see that an online consultation with online workshops was a poor choice for that engagement. Instead of bringing parties together, the Scottish Government have managed to pit NGOs and fishing and coastal communities against one another. Industry, NGOs and community groups have called for better spatial management plans that take advantage of local historic knowledge and better balance industry and the need for conservation and nature-based solutions. Many of these stakeholders cite inadequate funding, unclear objectives and a lack of data as key barriers to proper implementation of marine spatial planning. Much of the current Scottish Government's marine policy, I think, is driven by Scottish Green Party ideology and misleading international comparators rather than science-based evidence. The Scottish Government have admitted as much in response to portfolio questions, stating that they do not have the data to validate their policy choice, but rather have policies based on, and I quote, how best we can develop policy in the absence of science and data. Similarly, Scotland Marine Assessment 2020 explicitly stated, and again I quote, there is insufficient data to allow detailed assessment. Deputy Presiding Officer, that is no way to approach such important legislation. Legislation that can have such a detrimental impact on communities reliant on a robust and sustainable blue economy. Scottish Government guesswork is what they are being offered. Proposing HPMAs with very little evidence on their impact in temperate waters is just not ridiculous, it's hugely irresponsible. Our fishermen must be part of the solution to dual nature and climate crisis, but only if we create the policy context for them to participate. Our fishing sector and coastal communities have a unique local knowledge passed down over generations that is invaluable to the formation of policy. For example, the Clyde Fishermen's Association has been in operation since 1934. They, like many local fishers, understand their role in ensuring the long-term viability of their industry. For example, the CFA have advocated for a weekend fishing ban in their local area and engaged proactively with Marine Scotland in the formation of the Clyde MPAs to support healthy fishing stocks. Their practical knowledge is instrumental to their advances in gear selectivity on significantly reduced bycatch. We must draw on an extensive knowledge base from across the industry. The people who understand the sustainability of our seas most are those who gain their livelihood from it. They have been doing that for decades, Deputy Presiding Officer. Furthermore, there is a body of evidence to suggest investment in the seaweed sector can also help us achieve our net zero goals and improve our marine habitats. This is similar to Scotland's forestry sector and their approach to tree cultivation to lock in carbon as we produce other projects. During the duration of their cultivation, the farms can also produce a temporary habitat which has been shown to act comparably to wild nursery habitats. Special consideration must be given to the spatial squeeze that our marine environment is under, and it is important to note there is scope to grow seaweed alongside existing industries such as salmon and shellfish farming, integrating multi-tropic aquaculture, and even renewable energy installations. In some cases, The presence of seaweed may improve environmental quality by reducing the negative impacts of traditional fish farming practices, helping to maintain and grow fish stocks. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government seems intent on pursuing an ideological policy without considering the ecosystem and climate solutions as a whole, and are doing so without any meaningful data or research. That is why there has been such a pushback and alarm from our fishing and coastal communities against Scottish Government proposals on HPMEs. A lack of any clear scientific basis for the proposals and a significant lack of any relevant data pertaining to softbed ecosystems. Comparing Scotland's inshore coastal waters to tropical waters such as the Great Barrier Reef is ridiculous. The Scottish Government must halt its current direction of travel, halt its plans for HPMEs, work with coastal and fishing communities, NGOs and academia to collate the appropriate data to deliver a comprehensive, effective policy. Not to do so will be to turn your back on those communities. Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whistle. I now call Alistair Allen to be followed by Rosa Grant. Dr Allen.
Presiding Officer, can I begin by thanking Beatrice Wishart for securing this important member's debate. Over the course of the consultation period for highly protected marine areas, the level of fear across my constituency about what these proposals might mean for our islands has grown, although some recent remarks from both the Cabinet Secretary and the First Minister have certainly served to reassure about the Government's intentions. But following the consultation paper, individual island communities have had serious concerns that any designation around their own coastline would effectively end all forms of fishing and aquaculture for them overnight. And while it is important to say that it is only 10% of Scotland's seas which would be affected by the proposals, the difficulty is that no indication is being given yet of which areas are to be affected, and every community therefore presently fears the worst. There is time, I believe, to address those fears if we act, as I believe the Government is willing. However, Presiding Officer, I have to be direct. I have never known my constituency to be so apparently unanimously opposed to any single policy in all my time serving as an MSP as this. And it's not just those involved in the fishing industry. Literally everyone who has spoken to me or written to me on this issue locally has expressed total opposition to the proposals as they stand. Even on recent primary school visits, HPMAs have been the first thing that many pupils have wanted to ask me about. My own consultation response details many of the concerns expressed to me by constituents about the potential ramifications of these proposals locally, and so I will not attempt to cover these in detail in the little time available. However, the key question is, in the case of a local HPMA designation, what would that mean economically to the coastal communities so affected? On the West Coast, many fishing vessels are too small, realistically, to work further afield. Even if they did, creelers would face the task of re-establishing grounds to work, and fish processing would be unlikely to have a future in any community potentially where fishing and aquaculture had come to an end effectively. Now, these measures would disproportionately, if implemented, I believe, punish low-impact and more sustainable forms of fishing. And with sites not due to be selected for another 2 years, I'm afraid this issue will be hanging over every coastal community between now and the site selection decisions being taken. Fishers and others who rely on the sea to make their living fully recognise the need to tackle biodiversity loss, and that loss is certainly real. But nobody I have spoken with in the islands believes that a blunt approach is the best way to go, and I would question how any such approach would be compatible in the end with the Scottish Government's commendable drive to tackle rural depopulation, as well as the overall aims and commitments set out in the National Islands Plan. So when officials finish processing responses from the HPMA consultation, I believe, I cannot prove this, but I believe that they will find islanders from all walks of life and all political persuasions fairly united in the Western Isles, in any case, to the proposals as they currently stand. And, Presiding Officer, to conclude, I know that the First Minister gets this, as does the Cabinet Secretary. I'm very grateful for their commitment that HPMAs will not be imposed on communities who do not want them. We all know that the consultation responses will show anger and opposition, but they will also show our coastal communities passion and positive ideas for growth and sustainability in the islands. We can have that conversation with the starting point being the government's welcome commitment not to impose HPMAs on communities which view them as an existential threat.
Thank you. Dr Allen, I now call Rhoda Grant to be followed by Fergus Ewing. Ms Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would also like to thank Beatrice Wishart for securing this debate. This is an issue that's caused great consternation in fishing communities. The Scottish Government has told them that their future is at stake and expects them to take that quietly. Fishing communities have harvested the seas for generations. It's their living. It's not in their interest to harm their own livelihoods. But the Scottish Government, with the arrogance of imperial masters, tell them they know best. They know their seas better than the people who have fished them all their lives and depend on that knowledge of the sea for their very survival. It's little wonder they're angry and that they're writing protest songs and that they simply won't accept this. And can I also bust the myth that these imperial masters promulgate? That left unchecked, our fishers will destroy the marine environment. Fishing communities actually want to nurture and protect the seas. It's life or death to them. They are more motivated to do this than any pen-pushing pseudo-environmentalist sitting behind a desk in Edinburgh.
Cabinet Secretary Mary McCullough.
Thank you. I'm very grateful for the member taking an intervention, and I understand deeply her points on this. I just wanted to question, though, how what she's saying reconciles with the fact that she was elected on a manifesto commitment to 20% highly protected marine areas, double what the Scottish Government is currently working through.
Rhoda Grant.
And this then gets to the nub of the matter. This is not about protecting the marine areas. It's about how you protect them. You don't do that top down. You do it bottom up with those who want them protected as much as you do. And that's my point. It's those that fish the seas that are motivated more to protect the seas than anybody else. And I'll give you an example of that. When I was first elected to this parliament, I represented the community in Lough Torridon. Now, that's the area I was brought up. And the community badly wanted to close the loch to mobile gear boats, and it took persuasion to make that happen. Meetings, negativity, it was close to impossible. And that community was looking to preserve their income and their fishery and their livelihoods. And it took a long time, but eventually this was granted, but it was not easily obtained. And the results were positive, so positive that the area became a honeypot for static gear boats, and that was threatening the good work that had been put in place. So the community then again asked for the powers to manage the fishing effort, and again they were rebuffed. It was the same top-down approach that we're seeing now. The Scottish Government's condescendingly telling communities that they need how they need to work and how they need to manage their seas is simply wrong. And again, it's the same Scottish Government when they reduced quota in the North Sea, then encouraged boats from the North Sea to fish the Minch and hoover up the prawn quota. The prawn quota was finished in 6 months, putting the very survival of those fisheries and communities in balance. That was the Scottish Government, not the fishers in those communities. These same communities want the Scottish Government to look at what they are doing. The Scottish Government cannot take the moral high ground over them, because they can't. They have to stop. Looking after our seas and managing them.
Yeah. Edward Mountain.
The member will remember in 2016 this government was elected on the principle of bringing an inshore fisheries bill, which they fundamentally failed to do. Does the member believe, presiding officer, that if they'd brought that bill in, they wouldn't have had to do this knee-jerk reaction without consulting anyone and could have gone through the proper process, which they supposed to have started over 7 years ago, presiding officer?
Rhoda Grant.
Absolutely. Managing our seas has to be devolved to local communities. They depend on the fisheries for their very survival, and they need that fishery to continue for future generations. So we must help them, we must support them, we must empower them to protect our seas, and I would urge the Scottish Government to do just that.
Thank you, Ms Grant. I now call Fergus Ewing to be followed by Liam MacArthur. Mr Ewing.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I warmly thank Beatrice Wishart for bringing this debate and the opportunity to speak in it here today, and I congratulate her on her excellent contribution and enjoyed listening to all members speak thus far. Presiding Officer, I've spent 49 years campaigning in various capacities to support, to provide succour to our fishermen and fishing communities throughout Scotland, starting off as a schoolboy campaigning for our mother in 1974 when she successfully won Murray and Nairn from then Gordon Campbell, and she thought that she had the fishing community on her side during the campaign. It was a cold count, so the votes weren't counted until the Friday, but she went on the election night programme and was interviewed by the anchor man of the elections results from London, who asked her this at midnight after the votes had been counted elsewhere but not in Murray. "Well, Mrs Ewing, how have you done in Murray and Nairn?" And she said, "I won." And he said, "How can you possibly know? Because the votes haven't been counted yet." And she said, "Because the boats came in." At that point, the BBC executive producer was completely mystified. He didn't understand that postal votes weren't a thing then, and the fishermen came in. They disrupted their fishing effort in order to cast their vote for Winnie to fight for them. And in those days, Presiding Officer, it was precisely because the fishing community had lost confidence in the Conservatives under Ted Heath. Now, my fear is that they are now losing confidence in the party I've served for nearly 50 years in our Scottish Government. I've had the privilege of serving as the MSP for Lochaber for 8 years, now in Kate Forbes' capable hands, and I got to know the fishermen in Mallaig and in Arisaig, and I got to understand and appreciate what they do, producing food on our table, hard-working, great characters, many of them very God-fearing as well, and making a huge contribution to Scotland. And over the years, it's the fishing community that have gone on to form the backbone of the Merchant Navy. And then in the 70s and 80s, working offshore in our oil and gas industry, because they were already familiar with the perils of working in the cruel sea indeed. They did then and still do now put their lives at risk for us. They deserve our respect. They deserve our thanks. But what have they got in this document? The only mention of fishermen is that what they do is destructive. What an incredible act of provocation that is. Plenty also, I've got a list of questions here about this consultation document. Some have been asked already. Why didn't the government sit down with fishermen at the beginning? Work with them, as Beatrice said, and local management, to learn what they do. After all, no one's got a more interest in fishermen than preserving stocks for the future, for their family coming on. No one knows more about it than they do. You can't convince me that an academic working in a university behind a typewriter knows more than the fisherman working the sea. So, where do we go from here? Well, Presiding Officer, I do think, and I've urged the Minister already to do this, I know she's rejected it, but this will haunt the Scottish Government, this issue. This will not go away. This is not a consultation document. It's a notice of execution, together with the inshore cap and the special marine features, which are really putting the fear of God into our fishermen. And the collective impact of all of that means that the anger, as Dr. Allen has already said, is palpable. And in 49 years, I have not come across anything like it. So, the Minister should withdraw the document, apologise, get round the coast, go round all the fishing ports, or most of them, as I have tried to do in my time. And then she should go back to the drawing board and work with the fishing communities. And in the meantime, in conclusion, Presiding Officer, with regard to this document, I've got three suggestions to make about what to do with it. First of all, put it in the burgeoning policy recycling unit, along with the advertising ban and deposit return. Secondly, if you prefer, use it as a firelighter. But thirdly, what I think, and in doing this, I think I'm summing up the views of the people I've worked for and value and cherish for nearly 50 years. This is what to do with it, Presiding Officer. This is what to do with it. I do it now. That is what the people of Scotland, who have great affection for our fishermen, want to happen, and what should happen, and what I believe will happen at some stage or another.
Thank you, Mr. Ewing. I now call Liam MacArthur to be followed by Emma Harper. Mr. MacArthur.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I join others in thanking my colleague, Beatrice Wishart, not just for allowing this evening's debate, for the tenacity she's shown in terms of articulating many of the concerns we've heard here this evening, and on behalf of her own Shetland constituency. I'm a great fan, always have been a great fan, of members' debates. I've participated in many in recent times for the privilege of chairing a good many as well, and I think often they're underestimated. I think anybody tuning in to this evening's members' debate will be left in no doubt whatsoever about the powerful message they can often send. And I think we've heard to date from each of the speakers about the response to these proposals on HPMAs. We're seeing them in coastal and island communities right around Scotland. I think Dr. Allen's absolutely right in terms of the reaction in his constituency. It's echoed very much, I think, in my own constituency. There's an anger, there's a confusion, but equally there's a determination, an absolute resolution to see off these proposals for very good reasons that I will come on to. But I think Karen Adam was also right to point out that they are already having an impact in terms of the uncertainty that they've created. And similarly, I think Brian Whittle was right to say that, in a sense, they've made it far more difficult to come to a resolution at the end because emotions are running so high that the faith and the confidence there is within our island and coastal communities has been undermined. And I'm happy to take an intervention.
Brian Whittle.
I'm very grateful for the member taking an intervention. Would he also agree with me that it is impacting the ability to recruit into the sector as well because of the uncertainty that this bill is bringing?
Liam MacArthur.
I very much agree. I think that was the point that Karen Adam was making, whether it's coming into the sector, whether it's people seeking to buy new vessels, that uncertainty cannot be anything other than a bad and a damaging thing. And I think it's the combination of the blunt and arbitrary nature of the proposals, the combination of the 10% on the one hand, which, as Alistair Allen reflected, has everybody suspecting that they may be part of that 10%, but also the deadline of 2026, which in terms of what the government is seeking to achieve here, is a ridiculously short time frame. It seems entirely arbitrary on the basis of when the next election falls. And I think that is driven by the fact that the whole commitment emerges from a Bute House agreement that rides roughshod over the development of policy that there has been over many, many years. The fisheries strategy from 2019 will have been an iterative process through engagement with the sector, through the engagement with stakeholders, through the development of evidence. And I think what has happened within the equivalent of smoke-filled rooms in Bute House are is something that is wholly arbitrary. The evidential base is just not there. The message from government for years has been about local management, about local control, about local engagement. And what we're seeing, and I take my own Orkney constituency as an example, is fishers who absolutely recognise that their sector is reliant on a healthy ecosystem and a healthy marine environment. It's why they've been working with research academics, with environmental groups, on a range of conservation initiatives over recent years. And to have this top-down approach then imposed upon them has left them absolutely baffled. Now, there are a few minor bright spots. The assurance from the First Minister and repeated by the Cabinet Secretary that none of these proposals will be imposed on communities is welcome, but there's no definition of what a community is or what the level of opposition would be required to be. I welcome Mary McCallan's willingness to engage with MSPs across the Parliament and welcome the meeting she held with us earlier on today. I don't want to breach any confidences from that meeting, but I'm absolutely sure she will be left in no doubt about the strength of the cross-party feelings there are on this bill. So let's not mistake the opposition we're seeing to this as an unwillingness to engage on what will genuinely safeguard the future of our fishing sector, our aquaculture sector, to all those that rely on our marine environment through having a protected marine environment. But let's not also be in any doubt that the government will be able to find a way to railroad through these proposals on the basis of the Bute House Agreement, because they will not have the numbers in this Parliament. I look forward to the remainder of the debate. I look forward to participating in tomorrow's debate. I don't think we can give this issue enough focus at the moment. But again, I thank Beatrice Wishart for giving us this opportunity to reflect on these concerns. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms MacArthur. And I now call Emma Harper to be followed by Arianne Burgess. Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I also want to thank Beatrice Wishart for securing this debate, and I want to start by supporting some of what she said in her motion. We all know and we all agree that fishing is hugely important to Scotland's coastal communities, including across Dumfries and Galloway and the Scottish borders. I also agree that any decision taken should be on the basis of robust evidence and assess their impact, and that stakeholders must be fully involved in the process. Presiding Officer, in March, after nearly 20 years of discussion, 193 countries agreed to a new high seas treaty which will protect 30% of the ocean by 2030. The UK Government also recently announced the creation of three highly protected marine areas in English waters. One of them is on the English side of the Solway Firth. It is internationally accepted that the world needs to do more to look after the marine environment, and there is cross-party support for HPMAs across the UK. However, the process by which this is achieved must be carefully managed, and people's livelihoods, indeed their way of life, for many of our coastal communities must be considered and even protected, and any change must be in full consultation with these communities. I know that there is a vast amount of work that needs to be done before any location is decided upon, and I would ask that acceptable socio-economic impact should be a key indicator of a successful outcome. And as it stands, the policy framework seems to be a bit unclear based on the feedback that has been provided to me, to what degree designations within the Scottish inshore region would contribute to this overall 10% target that applies to both inshore and offshore regions. Galloway is home to many inshore fishers who fish in the Solway and the Irish Sea and beyond. Scotland's inshore waters extend from the coast out to 12 nautical miles, with a concentration of fishing taking place within 6 nautical miles. And there are over 2,000 active Scottish fishing vessels, and 3/4 of them fish primarily in inshore waters. And the inshore fleet is diverse and includes trawlers, creelers, netters, dredgers and divers. And we should absolutely thank them all for putting food on our tables. The sector contributes £284 million to Scotland's economy, providing employment to many in our rural communities, and I appreciate Karen Adams' point about the importance of the blue economy. The Galloway Static Inshore Fishers, Clyde Fishing and Fishing Representative Bodies have contacted me also as a South Scotland MSPs with coastal waters on both sides of my region, and they have asked me to convey their concerns. So I'm asking on behalf of my constituents whether removing of the arbitrary, which is perceived as arbitrary, 10% target of HPMA, and instead can we focus on acceptable socio-economic impact, will that be considered? Also, whether exclusion of current inshore waters, such as the Solway or the Irish Sea, from HPMA proposals can be considered, and also could clarity be provided on the evidential basis for restricting water sports, including swimming and kayaking, etc., from HPMAs? That's important for folk in Loch Ryan. I also asked the Minister for a commitment that before any HPMA is enacted, that our static and mobile gear fishing communities are properly consulted with and that their concerns will be addressed. The purpose of HPMAs, in as far as they align with the Scotland's nature conservation strategy, is reasonable, and the principle of taking a whole site approach in targeted areas would hopefully achieve positive biodiversity outcomes. However, implementing such a programme of work must appropriately, in my last 10 seconds, I think, However, implementing such a programme of work must appropriately recognise the drastic step change that this represents for designations in the marine space and the existing users and coastal communities that will be affected. Presiding Officer, positive biodiversity aspirations are important, as are actions to support them, and I know any actions will be well considered by the Minister, by the Cabinet Secretary, and to ensure that outcomes are both successful and just. So, Presiding Officer, I will conclude there because I'm conscious of the time. I know that target for protecting the areas, it must consider all waters and not just the Scottish Government currently has delegated authority over, and the integration of critical socio-economic considerations and thorough community engagement must be embedded at an early point in the process. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Harper. Due to the number of members who wish to speak in this debate, I am minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 8.14.3 to extend the debate by up to 30 minutes. I now invite Beatrice Wishart to move a motion without notice.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Wishart. Do members agree to extend the debate this evening? That is agreed. I now call Ariane Burgess to be followed by Kate Forbes. Ms Burgess.
Thank you, and I'd like to thank my colleague Beatrice Wishart for securing this debate and giving us the opportunity in the Chamber. Scotland is an islands nation, and our marine waters are our last great commons. But they are under threat from decades of damage, and it's commendable that Shetland's Shellfish Management Organisation allocates limited fishing licences for local shellfish. But 80% of Shetland seafloor is in poor condition due to towed bottom contact fishing. Presiding Officer, Scotland as a whole is failing in its duty, its legal duty, to maintain our seas to good environmental status. Disturbance of the seabed is widespread, and total fish landings across Scotland are decreasing. Living seabed habitats like flame shell beds that provide spawning and nursery grounds for fish have suffered catastrophic decline. This threatens not only fish, seabirds, and marine mammals, but also us humans. If we don't take action...
Brian Whistle.
Very grateful for the member giving an intervention, taking an intervention. I wonder if she could tell me which species she thinks are in danger of extinction, and is that verified by some neutral verified science by any chance?
To include crofters.
Ariane Burgess.
Apologies, member, I was being distracted by somebody else, but I would like to just say that this is a crucial next step to aid marine ecosystem recovery in our waters, and I'm delighted to see my recommendations become a reality today. Not only will the first of three highly protected marine areas protect important species and habitats, but they will propel the UK forward in our mission to protect at least 30% of the global ocean by 2030. And that was Marine Minister Lord Bennion, a Tory, on the HPMAs for England. I'm going to continue because I think I need to use the time. If we don't take action, fish stocks will continue to suffer, making it harder and harder to earn a living as a fisher. And losing the flood defences provided by healthy coastal habitats would cost billions. Shetland's fisheries are faring better than most, but other coastal communities are realising that it is collapsing fish stocks that threaten coastal economies, not increased protection. It's time for communities to step up and demand change. And in the continuing months, coastal and island communities can continue to shape the ocean recovery network of our highly protected marine areas. The Cabinet Secretary will hold meetings and workshops. Marine Scotland assured me that the coastal communities will be central when they get together in a room with maps and draw them out in a very collective manner. There will be a second public consultation on locations, and anyone will be able to submit proposals for sites. We should go further. We need a process for communities to meaningfully input into wider spatial plans for their inshore waters, which could include HPMAs as part of a package of measures that works for each community. And it is about the whole package. Fishing is indispensable, but it makes up just 6% of marine economic value and 7% of marine employment. Our coastal economies are a rich tapestry, including recreation, hospitality, tourism and shipping, and the increasingly growing sector of nature restoration. And many of these will benefit from HPMAs, just like in Arran, where the Lamlash Bay no-take zone has increased both tourism and catches of lobster near the HPMA zones, and where we also hear that generally the ecosystem is flourishing. Lamlash Bay is demonstrating multifaceted benefits from high protection. It should be recognised and funded as a formal pilot. But we can also draw on the ample international evidence, including benefits for fishers outside HPMAs in California, Florida, New Zealand and the Mediterranean, where the fishers asked for them to be brought in. HPMAs have piqued public interest in marine management. Let's seize this opportunity to catalyse a process of community wealth building all along our coastlines. Through careful co-design and management with our coastal communities, we can create world-famous HPMAs where visitors and residents alike enjoy the beautiful nature-rich waters, with the benefits literally spilling over for local fishers and the ecosystems on which we all depend.
Thank you, Ms. Burgess. And I call Kate Forbes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I can't think of a more important issue to speak on as my first speech from the backbenches since 2018. And I'm delighted to be back, but not delighted about the substance of this debate. Because, Presiding Officer, in a debate about conservation, my warning is stark. The rarest species in our coastal areas and our islands will soon become people if these proposals go ahead as planned. And we look at the figures to back that up. The National Records of Scotland are clear that all of our coastal areas will see double-digit reductions in population between 2018 and 2044. The Western Isles, Argyll and Bute, Inverclyde. It's people and depopulation that are at greatest risk. And yet, despite that bleak outlook, there are signs of recovery. That recovery is driven in many areas by fishing. Let's look at Tyree. In Tyree, fishing supports 20 full-time jobs that in turn support 25% of the children under the age of 8 years old on the island. And every one of those children are in the Gaelic medium unit. Language, heritage, culture, that is what drives tourism. And yet, sever the lifeline with fishing, you undermine the wider economy. My position in the leadership contest was that I would scrap HPMAs completely if elected. I didn't win. And my job now is to represent my constituents and to navigate a way forward. And I think the statement from the seafood sector, which I believe is to be issued tomorrow, offers a way forward to either drop the proposals or to find a clear consensus, and consensus requires fishermen's voices to be part of that discussion, to find a clear consensus on balancing protections in the marine environment and safeguard tens of thousands of jobs. I was hugely heartened by the comments from the First Minister and indeed from Mary McCallan, who's been exceptional in engaging, that no communities will see HPMAs imposed on them out with their will. The difficulty, of course, is that I haven't come across a single community who do want it. And so I think the challenge will be finding anywhere to impose these HPMAs. I haven't taken interventions because I wanted to use the last minute of my comments to quote the words of a fisherman. Because this isn't about taking politicians' words, it's about listening directly to those people. And I want to quote Donald Francis McNeill, who made his singing debut last month with Skippinish in the song Clearances Again. I'm not going to sing it, but you can hear it sung online. He sings, "Donald Francis McNeill is my name. I'm a fisherman through to the bone. I've lived by the creel and the wave to provide for a family and home. Generations before me have followed the toil and the call of the seas, but the soul will be torn from our future and the heart from the Hebrides.
My people, my language, my island, and the rights that our forefathers won to remain on the soil of our homeland by the sweep of a pen will be gone. A wrecking ball through our existence, tradition and culture condemned at the hands of the arrogant stranger, the clearances over again. But we'll join with the kin of our coastline, from Ness to the Holy Isle, faceless grey suits from the cities. They will not play games with our lives. My song marks a fight for survival, a Mayday call we cry. We will stand for the rights of our children. We will not let our islands die. May that be the rallying call, Presiding Officer, for this Parliament.
Thank you, Ms Forbes. And I now call on the Cabinet Secretary, Mary McCallum, to respond to the debate. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I should like to begin by thanking Beatrice Wishart for lodging this motion. I want to thank her and others for their contributions today, and for those of my colleagues who joined me on the round table that I held earlier on. I want to acknowledge the emotion that has been so clear in exchanges today and outside this chamber up until this point. And I suppose in response I want to commit that I will be balanced, I will be measured, and I will take this matter exceptionally seriously. And before I move to the substance of the Scottish Government's position, I just want to categorically remind the Chamber that we are at the very beginning of the development of this issue. That I have very deliberately consulted early and widely in that process, and that I am currently in the position of considering thousands of responses to the consultation that we set. Presiding Officer, I am committed to very closely considering the views that have been expressed as I decide the way forward, and noting the uncertainty that's been narrated by a number of colleagues, I commit to doing that as soon as I possibly can and to updating the Chamber in time. I'll take Rachel Hamilton and then
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you very much for taking the intervention. It's just really to put the Chamber in the picture of how long this the readings of the responses might take. So how many consultations did the Government receive, and how long do you think you might be able to get through those?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, earlier on in response to an interview that I was doing, I noted that we had had thousands of responses. I'm still working out how many of them are duplicates or how many of them were generated via campaigns, but we're looking at about 4,000 just now. And look, I can't put a time figure on exactly how long it's going to take us to meaningfully get through them, but I do commit to doing that as soon as I can. And I suppose to everybody who has been concerned by this proposal, I want to say, first of all, that I care. That I empathise. I am a rural MSP. I feel deeply connected to the land in a way that I know island and coastal communities feel connected to land, coast and sea. And finally, I would say that I am listening, and that consultation exercise is exactly what that's about. Yes, happily.
Liam MacArthur.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking an intervention as a member bringing forward a member's bill that's had 14,000 responses. I feel her pain, but wish her good speed in getting through those consultations. The point I was making, though, during the debate about the effect that the consultation and the way it's gone down in coastal and island communities is likely to make that whole process of reaching agreement more difficult. Is there anything that she can advise the Chamber today that will allow her to rebuild that trust and that confidence in a process which fundamentally at the moment is lacking that confidence?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I accept that there are different ways in which one can approach the consultation on what I understood was going to be an issue that would elicit a lot of different views. I could have done what has been done by DEFRA, and I don't criticise them in this, but I could have done top-down pilot approach. I felt that consulting as widely as I could right at the beginning of the process on the very principles of this, rather than the end point, was the best way to do that. I accept that that has potentially created a vacuum into which some mistruths have entered, and also concern has been allowed to grow. So in terms of how we address that, I'm here today. I'm meeting with MSPs. I've committed to meeting with coastal communities. I will very closely consider the consultation. Essentially, I will gather as much information as I possibly can on the views of how this proposal should be taken forward, and I commit to acting upon that as much as I can. Yeah, I'll take one last intervention.
Then I'm
very grateful if the Cabinet Secretary takes many interventions, but I think my point here is how can the Scottish Government consider HPMAs when they haven't assessed yet the effectiveness of MPAs? Surely we must gather that information first before you can move on.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, we have a statutory process for assessing the development of MPAs, and actually our consultation recommends that HPMAs would follow a similar statutory cycle of monitoring. And that brings me to the point that, you know, we know that, first of all, the IPCC is very clear that we are in a climate and nature emergency. Most recent assessments of the state of the marine area, both in Scotland and the UK, have demonstrated that I think in 11 out of 15 indicators of good environmental status, we are failing. And of course, all of that's happening on a backdrop where we know that the oceans store around 25% of the carbon dioxide emitted by humans and 90% of the heat from human-caused climate change. Recent research shows that none of us can deny that whereas we need the ocean to help us maintain equilibrium in the natural world, the seas are reaching their capacity to assist us in that, and that is because of human impacts on them. So if we do not protect our seas, they will not be able to protect us. And that is a fundamental truth, but what is also a fundamental truth is that the actions that we take in response to that science, in response to that emergency, they must be carefully considered, they must be fair, they must be just, and in this case, they must be developed hand in hand with the people who are affected by them. And that is exactly what I am seeking to do. And of course, I should say that that idea that our economy and our environment are not in opposition with one another, but mutually inclusive of each other, is exactly at the core of our blue economy vision, recognising that economic prosperity and the well-being of our people are underpinned by nature and are not external to it. And, Presiding Officer, if there is anybody who understands that fact more than anyone, it is the people who live in our coastal and island communities who are socially, economically and culturally linked to our seas. And that's why it's been so important to me that they have been involved to date and that they will continue to be involved. Now, Presiding Officer, I am conscious of time. I did want to take as many interventions as I possibly could. But I suppose to conclude, this debate has raised many important points. I think we all recognise the importance of Scotland's coastal and island communities and the industries that support them. We recognise the importance, the indispensable value of working with them as we develop the policy. But at the same time, we must all recognise the threat that our environment is under. Every MSP in this chamber was elected on a manifesto which committed to protection of our environment. My colleagues in the Labour Party committed to 20% highly protected marine areas, and the Conservatives to piloting highly protected marine areas. There is agreement on the fact that marine protection is required. My job, which I take very seriously, is to make sure that we achieve those aims, but that we do it hand in hand with the people impacted by them, and I commit myself to doing that.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.